This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world.
Well, today on Dreamland, you have a treat in store for you. We're going to have a guest that we have never had before on the show, whom I was introduced to and was recommended by a number of friends, other friends, Diana Pasulka, Jeff Kripal, Joshua Cutchin, Alan Steinfeld, Anthony Peak, a lot of friends. And you'll see why in just a moment. I want to introduce you to a man who has created something that is, in a sense, a work of fiction, but it's not a work of fiction. It's something more than that. So say good morning or good afternoon, wherever you are. Good evening to Mike Fiorito. Hi, Mike. How are you?
Hey, Whitley. Thank you so much for having me on. Good afternoon. Good morning.
Good to see you. I'm looking forward to this.
Me too.
Well, wow. What a book. Let me just read a couple of the things people have said about it. Here's Diana Pasulka. For all we know is a manifesto for all of those fascinated by the numinous realities posed by the UFO. Mike finds the UFO in experiences as diverse as Catholic Mass to the modern rituals of heavy metal music, and reveals a decentralized transcendence, a fun and extraordinary experience. Diana Pasulka. And that is so deeply true. Now, this is a work of fiction because it has to be, in a sense, but it is also a journey of the soul, and that soul is your soul, and that's what we're going to be talking about, your journey. When did it start, Mike? Because this is the work of somebody who's gone very far into the close encounter experience and very deep.
Well, it started. It's interesting because it started. It's a funny thing. I wrote a book called Falling from Trees. It's a collection of short stories. This was 4 years ago or so. And these short stories were, and I have to say, at that time, I wasn't on the inside of the ufology path. I had not yet connected on that path. I had connected in different ways. So I wrote this book, these short stories that are imagine sentience in the future, the evolution of human consciousness, a communication with non-human intelligence. This book set in motion, it's interesting, I read Jeff Kripal's book, The Flip. I wrote to Jeff and I said, you know, I feel like I read your book before I wrote my book, but that was not the case. I felt like his book informed my writing. That book set in motion, Jeff Kripal's book, and then I read your books as well, and a slew. I mean, if I showed you my library, it's kind of daunting. My wife won't let me bring any more books into the house. But
let me just stop you right here. Let's read what Jeff Kripal said in the book about your book. The UFO phenomenon is about many things, some of which can only be transmitted in the genre of fantastic literature itself, based on dreams, altered states, and out-of-body experiences. Mike Fiorito knows that and writes what he knows. Flying saucers appear alongside books, both of which appear alongside the so-called dead. We are them. Take that as large and vast as you can. What a statement.
Yeah.
Tell us a little bit about the dead in your life as you understand that presence.
So a lot of my communication comes through dreams. I was reading the Afterlife Revolution while my mother was basically dying. And unlike you, you've had these elaborate communications. And I do want to touch on how there's something similar that happens to me, but it's not necessarily communicating with the dead. For me, Whitley, there was a revelation of the continuity of life and death. And when you're with someone who's in the transitioning stage and then is no more, and the revelation is they're released into, you know, them, they're released back into the earth, into their constituent parts. And now they're in your dreams. So I do have, I'm a very deep dreamer, and I keep a dream journal, and I do want to read some from some of my dreams. But there's this, for me, there's the revelation, and I think your writing can buttress this this take of it is one continuous fabric of from here to there. And what Jeff was alluding to is penetrating that veil through different modalities. It could be through out-of-body experiences. It could be through a psychedelic experience, of which I've written a lot in the book as well. And it could be through
dreams. You've had that psychedelic experience. Yeah. I gathered that from the book, yeah.
Yeah, and I, you know, I didn't want to. It's not like I'm promoting it. It's a powerful way to get out of your ego. And yeah,
it's a tool, definitely, for that. And that's exactly, actually, what it does is it shuts down the ego.
Mm-hmm.
Meaning that probably, for the most part, you start to see the real world. I can't do psychedelics, sadly enough. I've got an unusual brain, but I have the same effects. I'm sort of a self... I have my own psychedelic machine inside my head.
You do.
So I know exactly what you're talking about. That's what I'm saying. But let's go on with you.
Yeah. No. You do. And I think what I wanted to approach in this book is I didn't want to do the usual story. I wanted to look at the commonplace. So the commonplace experience, when I say commonplace, the not the untypical. If we take the psychedelic experience, I mean, Terence McKenna wrote about that pretty extensively, and he believed it was a medium to communicate to non-human intelligence. And he had some of it is they're quite hysterical as well. But he used it, and he talked to shamans who believed that they could vomit up ayahuasca, spread it on the ground, and use it in a way as a scry, or to navigate space-time, to engineer space-time.
I had never heard that before. Can you tell us more about that?
Yeah. So in, I think it's either in the archaic revolution or true hallucinations, but this shaman vomited up ayahuasca, and this is something was common. It wasn't a one-off thing. And then would spread that on rock. And then from that could, navigate other places in the way that when you read about non-human intelligences that are able to do what a level 3 civilization can do to re-engineer space-time. And I see these things as a coalescence. So that can happen through dreams. That can happen through extraordinary experiences. People like you who have your antenna is you're beaming, they're beaming in to you. And I've heard you say at various occasions, they're coming to you. You don't have to put anything out there.
No, fortunately, I'm a cheap guy and I don't have to spend the money. So anyway, but let's get back to this. What you're saying essentially is that there is a convergence here of paths. One is the path of writing of books for you, mm-hmm. and the other is the path of this journey into this other world. And you've woven a kind of a fiction out of it. Mm-hmm. Would that be accurate?
That is. That is, and I did want to keep it fiction because number one is publishers won't talk to you. If you are going to write a testimonial, they don't want to talk to you.
No.
Unless you self-publish.
That's why I publish myself.
Exactly. I wanted to be read. Also, I think that some people will not pick up a book when it says UFO and it says testimonial. They just won't pick it up.
Most people won't pick it up.
Right. They won't pick it up. No. My intention was to invite other people into the conversation. I've done a lot of research and I've put a lot of thought in. I mean, I have a philosophy undergrad degree. I've taken, you know, philosophy of mind, philosophy of science. Those things do factor into the writing. And then I went on to an English literature master's. But I wanted to, in a way, I don't want to say sneaky. I wanted to have a way to invite other people into the conversation, people who have taken psychedelics, people who have had out-of-body experiences, people who are intense dreamers, to invite them into this conversation, which to me is the most important philosophical conversation. Who are we? Why are we here on this planet?
And what is looking at us? Because something is looking at us. Listen, we're going to take our first break.
Yeah.
And so those of you on the free side, you'll see all of you will see an image of the book. I urge you to buy the book and read it because the book, in a certain way, is very transcendent. It's a healthy thing to do, to read a book like this. Not to mention the fact that despite the fact that it's healthy, it's also loads of fun. Okay, we'll be right back. This is Whitley Strieber. Listen to me now from June of 2010, talking to Alan Lammers about an incredible thing that happened to him on the island of Sulawesi in Indonesia.
Here you are in South Sulawesi in the little town in the district of Sandu Batu. What happened? You were told something rather strange.
Well, we were told before we went, like my friends that I work with the NGO, they told me that when you pack, because it kind of happened by accident, I went out to buy a raincoat. It rains quite a bit in this part of the world. And so I went out and I bought a yellow raincoat. And my friend said, I'm sorry, you can't take that to Walla Walla. And I said, well, why not? And he says, well, you can't wear that color. So anyways, excuse me. So I thought, okay, well, what colors can I wear? They said, well, you can only wear black or white. You cannot wear any bright colors, no bright green, especially no yellow. And, you know, that's all you should bring. And I said, well, what would happen? And they said, well, people disappear.
You will find the rest of that story, and it is brain-bending, in the June 5th edition of Dreamland, June 5, 2010 edition of Dreamland in the unknowncountry.com archive. This archive is one of the richest of its kind in the world, probably is the richest of its kind in the world, filled with extraordinary shows, of which this show is certainly one, this show with Alan Lammers. You will never have heard anything like it. It does what Dreamland is here to do. It opens your mind to the fact that we live inside a hidden reality that we prefer not to acknowledge, but not here. Here on unknowncountry.com, we do acknowledge it. We live in it and we love it. Subscribe today. You can't go wrong. Go to unknowncountry.com right now and get started.
Have you ever read Communion? Or have you never read Communion? It's out in a new edition. Very powerful, a subtly new cover that reflects the fact that the visitors are now looking back at us because they truly are. You can get it from the unknowncountry.com store as a Kindle, as a beautiful, sumptuous paperback, or as an unabridged audiobook read by me. It's the first time in the whole life of communion that it has been read in full in audio format. And believe you me, I felt that reading. I put my life, my memories into it. And I trust you can hear it in the voice. I sure felt it while I was reading. So get communion, listen to it, read it. Communion is of central importance to all of our lives.
We're talking to Mike Fiorito. For All We Know is the name of his book. Mike, do you have a website?
I do. It's MikeFiorito.com. I could type it into the chat.
No, no. Yeah, sure, if you wish to. But we will make sure it's featured. So you can go to, what will we find at MikeFiorito.com? The reason, I mean, I already know, to be honest with you, and I think, but the truth is, if you tell our listeners, it's much more likely that they'll get engaged.
Sure. Well, so it's a website about, it talks about my books, and, you know, I'm mainly a music journalist, and I do want to talk about that as well. So I do a lot, I've done a lot of music journalism. And it also shows some of the books I've done. I think I've done about 7 books. The last one before For All We Know was called Mescalito Riding His White Horse, which is a marriage of spirituality and bluegrass. Go figure that, huh?
Okay. I can't pass that up. A marriage of spirituality and bluegrass.
Yeah.
I go way back with the origins of this music.
Yeah.
I'm a huge Uncle Dave Macon fan, among other things. So I know where it came from.
Yes.
Let me know a little bit more about that.
Sure. Sure. I know you're from Texas. I believe you're from Texas.
Yes.
So I had a short interview was supposed to be with Peter Rowan, who is a bluegrass.
I know his work and love it.
Yeah, a great guy and super interesting. He's a self-proclaimed Buddhist, interested in wisdom traditions. And so Peter and I had a few conversations. And I'm getting these dreams and I'm getting these things coming to me. And I said, Peter, I'm seeing a bigger project. Would you be interested? He said, well, tell me about it. I said, it's where bluegrass meets Buddhism. And the title is called Mescalito Riding His White Horse. He goes, tell me more. And Peter played with Bill Monroe. Peter is very knowledgeable. Bill Monroe is the father of bluegrass, and very much so.
I know. Yeah. Ann and I were very privileged to be around in Bill Monroe's time. We went to many of his concerts.
Yeah. So you know, and there's real magic. There's magic in all music. This music, and when you're speaking to someone he's a source, Peter, and he knows it. He's a very down-to-earth regular guy, but he is a source. And he kind of had these, you know, nuggets and these anecdotes, and they were lighting me on fire. And I'm having these dreams, and then we're having synchronicities occur. So I said, Peter, I should send you my book, Falling from Trees. This way you'll kind of get a sense of my imaginative process. And he goes, you know, I wrote a poem called Falling from the Trees, which he then read to me. And so we were having, both of us, these synchronicities. And I think I wrote the book, I mean, maybe in 3 months, possessed completely.
That's and a I often wondered. Synchronicity, you just let it sort of pass by, but my goodness.
Yeah.
You were in sync on another level, and that other level is a lot. It sort of is reflected in your book, in the book we're talking about. There's a there's a connection that can't be put into words in nonfiction. I think that was what Jeff was referring to, but you captured it.
Mm.
And you know, it's fascinating to read the novel. You get to the point where in some way inside you is a real thing happening. It's fascinating. That's why you're on the show. This is probably the first novel I've done in 10 years.
Hmm.
So, wow. Well, thank you. This, mostly, I mean, we're looking for information. We want the facts here. Well, these are facts, all right, folks, but they're not the kind of facts you usually find in the world. You will find the facts when you read the novel, but you won't find them in the novel. You will find them in yourself.
Mm-hmm.
That happened to me. Oh, just as an aside, did you ask me for a quote by any chance?
I think I did.
Well, I knew it. When I saw all those other names, I knew darn well you had. And you're talking to somebody who gets sometimes 200 emails in a day, which are actionable, and I just did not see it, and I'm so sorry.
That's desperately
a need a personal assistant, but I also desperately need a bigger income if I'm going to afford such a thing. So there you have it. Okay.
Well, let's sell more books, right? I mean, that's the only way.
Yeah.
So one of the things you mentioned, if I could take on that, Whitley, is you mentioned one of the things I read in Diana Pasulka's book. I think it was her second book. It may have been American Cosmic. I don't remember which one, but how, and this is something I practiced, where you are the UFO. You are the vehicle of transition, of transportation.
Of transportation and transformation both.
Yeah. So in meditations, lying down, it works especially well, I discovered later, with using binaural beats. So Robert Monroe, the Monroe Institute, and all those Monroes.
I knew him,
right?
Too.
I'm sure you did.
Oh, yeah.
And there are different methods to, and that's kind of the theme of the book is, like you said, a spiritual journey, but you have to go explore ways to tap into it using a binaural beat, using music. I mean, that's a very central theme of the book, is music is a vehicle.
Let's talk about that a little bit, because I think you know a great deal about music and frequencies and things like that. I can tell from the way the book's connection and relationship to music, folks, is so fun. Please do enjoy it. Really, I'm very being very serious here, but tell us a little bit about the sort of inner meaning or the hidden power of music.
Sure. You know, I think there are a lot of levels. So I think at the very basic thing, the universe is noisy. I mean, from pulsars to grasshoppers rubbing their limbs together to the trees, of course, the birds. Humans have tried to mimic these sounds. We've tried to mimic them in music. And so just observing and being attuned and listening, first of all, just listening to the tremendous amount of sound that's in the universe, there's something meditative. I also think there are layers of culture. There are layers of meaning in music. So when I listen to music, jazz, I kind of drive my wife nuts, because I'm a deep listener, and I believe that this. Think of Close Encounters of Close Encounters, bum 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 bum. That there is an intelligence being communicated.
Yes,
that is inexplicable. I mean, there's the feelings we get. There's of course the emotions we get. Think of everything important that happens in life. There's a music accompaniment to it. Birthdays, graduations, death. There's a music modality of some kind. But I also think there's something there that when we hear it, we will be hearing something, a communication that is extraordinary. And I think it's buried in the matrix of the music. And you hear it in bluegrass. Well, you can hear it in any music, I think. You can hear it in disco.
The thing is, you can hear it in bluegrass very well. You know, folks, you know, music is a spiritual journey. Rock is a spiritual journey. All kinds of music. Spiritual journeys are very profound. And I agree with you about not only about bluegrass, but about all kinds of music. And tell us more about that, the spiritual journey that's in bluegrass, though.
Well, I think with bluegrass, it's very fast. And that's the way Bill Monroe codified it. He wanted to be, you know, he said to Peter Rowan, follow the horse's hooves, you know, and it has that kind of rolling rhythmic quality to it. But if you're not paying attention, think of like Dixieland jazz in a similar way. When you listen to Dixieland jazz, you have to listen probably 100 times before you begin to hear it, a song or something, because it sounds like bike horns, you know, not hearing it clearly. With bluegrass, deep in the matrix of that fast-paced sound, if you peel them, you peel those pieces, you begin to hear things more clearly. And there's a spiritual journey. I mean, often the songs are spiritual too. You know,
I drove my wife crazy too, because I have a tendency to listen to things time and time again.
Yes.
Did you ever come across a fiddler named Tex Logan?
Oh, sure. He played with Peter Rowan.
The transcendent.
Yeah.
I have every piece of Tex Logan music I can find. There's actually some good. There's even on YouTube, there's a concert where he is doing Cotton Eye Joe.
Mm.
And the title of the concert clip is Old and in the Way. And Ann and I were at the concert.
So you have to hear this. So the song you've just named, Old and in the Way, is a Peter Rowan song. So
that's how these things work. It's so fun. That's why I love doing the show.
And
we're weaving something together. It's so fun.
Yeah, we're stitching it. We have to participate in this, right? It doesn't just it may just land right in front of us, beaming and illuminating. But interestingly, so Peter's from Massachusetts. Tex, I know, is from Texas, and he was actually an engineer.
Unfortunately,
yeah, he was
his background is very weird, folks. Tex was a scientist and worked at Bell Labs.
Uh-huh.
And then he'd put on his cowboy hat, get out, fiddle out, and be probably one of the greatest fiddlers in the history of bluegrass.
Yes, and he was instrumental. Apparently, the bluegrass trail, it didn't go through New York City. It somehow, Peter said, it kind of passed New York, went Pennsylvania around New York for some reason. We can talk about that, but it went into Massachusetts, and he met Tex when he was because Tex was older than he was, and Tex kind of took him under his wing. I'm friends with his daughter, Judy Logan, and whenever I see I have a Facebook page it's a Peter Rowan appreciation page, and whenever I see a picture or something, I post it and I tag Judy, and she's very sweet and loves the kind of recognition.
I wonder if she has any of his music.
Maybe.
You know, because it would be great if someone put together a Tex Logan album and streamed it somewhere, you know. I mean, that is some of the greatest music ever performed.
I do. I could ask her. Music is funny. People get very proprietary about music. So so even in writing the book, Mescalito Riding His White Horse, which by the way is a lyric from Peter Rowan, he let me use his lyrics, which is very uncommon.
Yeah, it is true. Very uncommon indeed.
In literature, I can quote poetry. I can quote source as long as I footnote it. But music is very proprietary, and it's a very, very tricky thing. So I don't know. I can ask Judy. I've never actually met her, but we're friends.
Ask her anyway.
Yeah.
And let me know the result. You've got my email address.
I will.
Yeah. Okay. Well, let's get back to your book. I mean, we've digressed to here a little bit here because for some reason we've ended up talking about people I just adore. Tex Logan, Bill Monroe, Peter Rowan are all huge names in my constellation. But for those of you who are into other parts of areas of music, one thing you can be sure of, I'm there too. Even the most esoteric music there is. Now, I started out asking a question about frequencies, and we immediately got sidetracked. So let's do this. Let's take another break, and then we'll talk a little bit about frequencies, and then get back to the story and philosophy of For All We Know. We'll be right back. Who are they? Why are they here? What do they want with us? Why is it all so secret? All of these questions are explored in my new book, Them, in an entirely new way. What do Close Encounter reports tell us about what the visitors want with us? What is the military's experience? And can our memories be trusted? Can anything be trusted? Them answers all of these questions in a totally new way. It's available in hardcover, softcover, as a Kindle, and as an audiobook, read by me. Get Them today, and you can get it from the unknowncountry.com store, signed by me. unknowncountry.com. It's huge. It's much more than just a Whitley Strieber book site. It contains thousands of hours of interviews, meditations, podcasts of all kinds. My original hypnosis tapes are there. You can actually hear the moment that I discovered that I, at least, was not alone in this universe, in the office of Dr. Donald Klein so many years ago. Whitley Strieber audiobooks, Communion, Transformation, The Secret School, Breakthrough, Majestic, and so much more, powerful meditations, but more even than all that, it is a community of people who are either looking to gain contact or actually in contact now. There is no community like it in the world. It is absolutely unique. Contact really is happening here. That's what these shows are all about. That's what my life and this website are about. It's real, and it can be of enormous benefit to us individually and to mankind as long as we take our part and do it our way. This is what being a member of Unknown Country is about. So go to unknowncountry.com and subscribe today. Join us and join, very frankly, the future. We're back, folks. We're talking to Mike Fiorito, his book, For All We Know. We are also channeling Tex Logan and Bill Monroe, I hope, and hopefully others will come join the party. So I'm gonna try, probably fail, by the way, to get some Tex Logan music to play at the end of this show. But my guess is the copyright machinery, which is very thoroughgoing and very, very dumb, will prevent me from putting it on YouTube, even though I will get permission. Okay. Well, anyway, that'll happen probably. Let's talk about frequencies and their significance, because I know that you have you ever to get into this. How about we start with the experience of music while on hallucinogens, for example. Mm-hmm. Let's go. Let's go. I know you know something about that.
Oh, yeah.
I know you, more than just a little. So let's explore that.
Yeah. You know, I remember, you know, the first time having done it, say I'm about 17. And what you realize is the music has been created to take you on a journey. So some music, I mean, any music could, but some music especially. So say, for example, the Grateful Dead or the Allman Brothers, some music, you know.
Dead. Keep going, man.
Yeah. I mean, those, the Duane Allman's slide frequencies, the way he's playing those, they're very emotive, but they become a vehicle to take you to journeys. And I have watched, you know, was in my friend's bedroom and watching the entire, you know, talk about space-time being re-engineered and on a journey into the heart, the essence of things. And it could be any kind of music, some music you don't want to listen to. And I talk about it in the book. I went to a heavy metal concert, and that was a little scary on mescaline.
Yeah, I think that it might not be a good idea to do that, but I have to tell you, when I go into heavy metal, it's another world for me. But I'm so partial. I've never found a type of music. I know this. You know, when you open yourself to the unbelievable negativity that is in some music, you find that you can reach a higher plane by accepting its truth. Now, mm-hmm. So we disagree a bit on that, but go ahead. Let's go.
Yeah. You know, and I do think that what Aldous Huxley said is we can use these things and they open doors. And then we should also explore other ways, other modalities, you know, whether that be meditation or, but certainly, I would say the psychedelics break the doors down, and you've put a sledgehammer on that veil that separates us from what is right in front of us.
You know, it's something that has really, I've studied the biology of psychedelics mm-hmm. very extensively. read many books about this, and the precise way that psychedelics put the ego to sleep, basically. Mm-hmm. Now, where would you come out when I ask you the question, do you think that it's only on things like psychedelics that we actually see the real world? Is that the real world? And is it so strange? Because the truth is, this world of the ego, where we live, we're only used to it. But it's mm-hmm. very strange.
Yeah, I think it is another world. It is a real world for sure. And you know, Huxley used the term the reducing valve. So in order for me to go about my day, you know, foraging in the forest or whatever, and gathering and doing whatever you have to do, that blue little hint of light over there, that's shimmering right there. If that becomes a foreground of my awareness, which it can be, you know, on a psychedelic plant, a sacred plant, if it becomes that in my everyday, it stops me from being able to go about the business of gathering food, of taking care of everyday things. So that reducing valve, I think, keeps us on track with the basics of living. Now, if you do deep meditations, if you use a sacred plant, if you use binaural beats, some people have dreaming. I mean, when you're on a psychedelic substance, you are essentially dreaming awake. There's a book, Alan Hobson, I think, wrote a book, Dreaming While Awake, something like that, and exploring the physiology of dreaming and how it relates to the physiology of psychedelics. When you're dreaming, is that real? I think it's
I
real.
Wonder, I often think that's more real than this.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And when we meet others in our dreams, maybe we can't bring it back, and neither can they, but it changes the way we are. I've had in my life a lot of love, and I often fall in love with people I don't even know, especially when I go to a UFO conference and there'll be other experiences there, experiencers, close encounter witnesses, fall in love with them. I fall mm-hmm. in love with a whole room full of them all the time. And I think to myself, do we know each other on another level? And this isn't a theme in your book, but I have to ask you now about, have you ever had any classic UFO experiences? Because I couldn't find that from the book. I couldn't discern it.
The only, not a classic one where I've seen, I've had a UFO encounter directly. The only one that I could talk about, and I'm not sure, is just after 9/11. I was in Union Square. I live in New York City. And this had to be 9/13. And if you remember, because I believe you've lived in New York City at different times. You've written.
Oh, yeah, I lived in New York City for most of my life, actually.
Yeah. And maybe 9/13, September 13th, I'm looking up at the sky. Everybody was looking up at the sky. We were all obsessed with looking at the skies. And I see what looks like a kind of carrier still. You know, I can't tell you, I don't know height, about the where a helicopter might be, but silent, still. And it was kind of cloudy that night. Clouds are rolling, wispy clouds are rolling by. No one else was looking up. Only I saw it. Now, that could have very well been a military aircraft. I don't know. But what seems strange to me, thinking about it afterwards, why did no one else see it? Everyone was looking up all the time and kind of traumatized. We were all traumatized. So I don't know if that counts. I do know that, and I could read to you excerpts from my dream journal, that they penetrate the UFO concept and ideas and beings come to me in dreams very intensely. In fact, the writing of a lot of my writing comes from dream inspiration.
Yeah, I could feel that in the book. I definitely could feel that in the book. Let's do it. If you got some handy, excellent.
Yeah. Here's my dream. My dream journal.
Do this after. No. Don't hold it up again. After the show, text me, send me an image of that, and we'll put it in the show right here. Let me make a note of the time.
Sure.
Okay. So the folks will see that very nicely when we're talking about it. Okay.
And that became the basis for the cover of Mescalito, but I'll talk about that. So this was dreamt that the aliens were presenting me with examples of how they reveal themselves right in front of us. Letterings and expressions that we know contain hidden messages in clear day, but we don't see it. That's one. What do you think about that?
I think it's true. You know, I was just in, this is so strange in a way. There's a lot of synchronicity going on in this show, folks. And yeah. I was just writing in the book I'm working on now about the fourth mind, about the larger mind. I was just writing about how they can, the little gray people, can be completely invisible. Therefore, they could be anywhere. Our whole experience of life is actually not what it seems. And I think that note reflects that.
Like you said, you know, our ego gets in the way of seeing with our minds, with our hearts.
I think it's best to say that the ego gets in the way of the deep surrender that is necessary to make the journey toward the truth, towards one's own truth.
Mm-hmm. And that could even be the title of a bluegrass song. Can I read one more?
Oh, you can read many more. We're here to enjoy you, Guy, and I certainly am doing that.
Well, thank you. I dreamt that I saw a space shuttle type spaceship ripping across the sky. Many of them, one at a time, separated by about a minute. This seemed strange, but then a string of, and by the way, these are written as I wrote them at like 2:30 in the morning. So they're not edited. But then a string of circular ringed white UFOs shot across the sky. In addition to UFOs, this is interesting, Whitley, because I think it's represented in the book too. And it's, I'd like to talk about it for a minute. In addition to the UFOs, there were also gigantic pine trees, not standing tall, but lying sideways, connected to this long trail of UFO type ships. It seemed to my dreaming mind that the phenomena was reflecting the human mind back to us in this incredible display of power, that it was trying to represent itself to me in the way it thought I wanted to see it. And I'd like to mention that a theme of this book, first of all, for all we know, so I'm saying I have questions, I don't know. But one of the themes of the book is to connect the terrestrial with the extraterrestrial, as above, so below.
Right.
This continuity, we're looking out in the stars, but right here, I left the house today. I think it was felt like the first spring day. Immediately, I heard birds. I could feel spring coming. There's such rich intelligence right there. And we're passing it by all the time. We're not even paying attention. We don't hear the birds. We're not listening.
Where, if I may ask, people are going to be curious about where you live.
I live in Brooklyn.
In Brooklyn?
Yeah. And, oh gosh, what is it called?
Last I heard, it was still February. Am I wrong?
It is, but today was a warm day. It was maybe 55, and it was, markedly different. You know, when you feel, it felt like the birds, they're kind of pulling spring. They're pulling them, and they're the heavy lift and bringing it forward. But it's palpable that today was among the first times that I heard the birds signaling. And to my point that, and what we've been discussing, that the infinite is right here. And it's happening at this moment, and we're not seeing it. Maybe a psychedelic substance can take you there. Maybe a profound experience of some kind can take you there. Maybe binaural beats or vibrations, music can take you there. We are missing it all the time, or some of us always, and some of us sometimes.
Yeah. There are a lot of music videos on YouTube which are at a certain frequencies, different frequencies. That's what I was talking about. I'm very interested in that because I listen to that while I work, and it gets into you in deep ways. It's
interesting.
Fascinating.
They binaural beats or just frequencies? Are they random frequencies or very specific kinds?
Yeah, I have Bob Monroe's entire collection of.
Oh, okay.
I mean, not Bob Monroe. Bob.
We're doing the same thing.
Right, exactly. anyway, I have the entire collection of Robert Monroe's stuff.
Right.
I'm getting tangled up between Bill Monroe and Bill
Me too.
Monroe and Robert Monroe. Anyway, Robert Monroe told me a very interesting thing. He said he thought that his journeys out of the body had happened because his house, the roof of his house, was a pyramidal shape. I found that very interesting. Okay, but let's go ahead. Go ahead.
I find it interesting, though, that in using these binaural beats, he was having these communications with a non-human intelligence. And I think it's in Journeys Out of the Body.
Yes.
And extensive. And they even have a sense of humor. But it's not unlike the communications that you've described and that other people describe. This was one way that this was one modality that was used to penetrate that. Interesting that they wanted to provide guidance. they wanted to provide insights. They wanted to help, and they were giving warnings of you're not taking care of the planet.
Yeah.
You're not, you know, this seems to be a consistent thing across. And I know you have, what you've said is that the phenomena is we and the military sees the phenomena as cryptic, because it is cryptic, right? You say that its messages are cryptic.
Yes.
Intentionally. And therefore the military and people respond cryptically. And that's hard it's hard to argue with that, because we don't get linear easily in a consensus reality way, bits to interpret of what the phenomena, how it comes into our lives. It seems to come in enigmatically.
Enigma is its way, it is intended. And I think that it's as much our wish as it is the wish of the phenomenon itself to be enigmatic. Speaking of enigmas, folks, there's one enigma I just can't solve. And that is, why don't those of you who are not subscribers, which amount to listening to one of these shows between 70 and 100,000 people, why don't you subscribe? If 50 of you subscribed every week, I would be in seventh heaven. That said, goodbye, free dreamlanders. I see you next week.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by unknowncountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.